In this video, we're computing the moment of inertia of a disk. But instead of computing the moment of inertia for how hard it is to spin the disk, this time we're using a diameter as the rotation axis. In other words, we want to know how hard it is to flip a disk over. And we're given a strategy in the statement of the problem. We're going to break the disk into thin rods that are rotating about their centers. And we're going to use the previous result that the moment of inertia for a rod rotating about its center is 1/12 mL squared, where L is the length of that particular rod. So this is what our mass elements look like. And each one of those thin rods gives us an incremental contribution to the mass. We're going to call that dm. So that's an infinitesimal mass. Now I also drew a horizontal center line across the disk here because that gives us a reference point for measuring the y-coordinate of our dm. So that particular thin rod slice is located at a vertical coordinate of y. Now, as part of writing down the moment of inertia contribution for this thin rod, we need to know how wide it is. And we know the distance from the center of the disk to the end of the rod is equal to the radius of the disk, or capital R. This means we can get half the width of this rod by using the Pythagorean theorem on this right triangle, where one of the legs is y and the hypotenuse is r. That means the other leg of the triangle is the square root of r squared minus y squared. Now, before we write down dm in terms of all the parameters of the problem, we need a little reminder here about area density. And it's common to use a lowercase sigma for the area density. And this just means the mass per unit area, or the mass of this disk divided by its area. Well, anytime you have a given area, you can find the mass corresponding to that area by simply turning this around and solving for m. So any mass of a two-dimensional object is given by the area density multiplied by the area, provided that area density is a constant. And this means our dm is given by sigma, whatever the area density of this disk is, multiplied by the incremental area of that little slice. So how do we find the incremental area of the slice? Well, we have the length of this thin rectangle, but we still need the thickness. And the thickness is just a small increment of y, so that's dy. So now we can express the mass of our thin rod, dm, as sigma times the area of this thin rectangle, and that's going to be the length of it, which is twice the square root of r squared minus y squared, multiplied by the thickness of it, which is dy. So now that we have an expression for dm, we can write down an expression for the contribution this makes to the total moment of inertia, and we'll call that di. And here's where we use our previous formula for a thin rod rotating about its center of mass. That's 1/12 mL squared, where L is the length of the rod. So we get 1/12 times the mass, which is dm here, that's our infinitesimal contribution to the mass, times the length of this thing squared. And the length of it is twice square root r squared minus y squared. Now we can replace dm in terms of y and dy, the result we got on the previous line. So I have 1/12 times 2 sigma square root r squared minus y squared. And there's also a dy attached to that expression for dm, but I'll put that at the end. And I'm going to go ahead and square this 2 square root r squared minus y squared while we're at it. And that gives me 4 times the quantity r squared minus y squared. Don't forget to put that dy on there. That was part of dm. Now we start cleaning it up, and I see these constants 2 and 4. That gives me 8 and a 1/12 out in front that reduces to 2/3. And there's a sigma. And then I have r squared minus y squared multiplying the square root of the same thing, r squared minus y squared, which gives me an r squared minus y squared to the 3/2 dy. Now that we have an expression for di, the moment of inertia contribution of a single slice, entirely in terms of one variable, y, we use integration to sum up all of these contributions. So the total moment of inertia is the sum of all the contributions to the moment of inertia, the integral of di, and we'll leave the 2/3 sigma out in front. So we have the integral of r squared minus y squared to the 3/2 dy. And then we have to look for the limits of integration on y. What's the lowest value of y? If we go down to the bottom of the disk, that's a y value of negative r. At the top of the disk, a y value of positive r. So we're integrating from negative r to r. That completes the setup of the problem, but this integral is pretty tough to complete. we recognize it immediately as a trig substitution type of integral. If I replace y with r sine theta, I'll be able to exploit a Pythagorean trig identity to simplify this integrand. So if y is r sine theta, y squared is going to be r squared sine squared theta. We still have to transform the differential here. So if y is r sine theta, then dy is r cosine theta d theta. And we also want to transform the limits of integration, so we can just do the rest of the problem in theta space instead of y space. So for our lower limit of integration, when y is equal to negative r, that means I would have a negative r equals r sine theta. This means sine theta is negative 1, which happens at theta equals negative pi over 2. We do the same thing for the upper limit. When y is positive r, we get r equals r sine theta, which means sine theta is equal to 1, and this happens at theta equals positive pi over 2. So we start to make substitutions into our integral. Remember, we're replacing y with r sine theta, so we get r squared minus r squared sine squared theta. Inside those parentheses, that's all being raised to the 3/2 power. And the differential dy gives us r cosine theta d theta. On the next line, we'll take care of several things. First, we have an r squared to factor out of those parentheses, and that's being raised to the 3/2 power. That means square root it and then cube it, which produces a factor of r cubed. When we combine that with the r that's stuck to the cosine theta in the differential, that gives us r to the fourth. So we'll write it as 2/3 r to the fourth times sigma, the area density, integral from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. And then inside those parentheses, we're left with a 1 minus sine squared theta, which is cosine squared theta. So things are starting to get a bit simpler. We have a couple more things to do to set this up. First, I know that the cosine function is even. So if we're integrating on an interval symmetric about the origin, I can just take half the integral and double the result. So I'm going to integrate with a lower limit of 0 and move a factor of 2 out in front. This will save us some work in the end. So I write it as 4/3 r to the 4th times sigma, integral from 0 to pi over 2. And then the integrand simplifies because I have cosine squared to the 3/2. I take the square root and cube the result. That gives me cosine cubed theta times another cosine theta. So I have the integral of cosine to the 4th theta d theta. And this integral is actually a pretty challenging trigonometric integral. We have to use the identity that cosine squared theta could be written as 1/2 times the quantity 1 plus cosine of 2 theta. And the usefulness of this identity is for reducing even powers of a trig function. There's a similar one for the sine function as well. So cosine to the 4th, we just think of that as cosine squared squared. And when we apply this identity to each copy of cosine squared, we get a 1/4 out in front. That's going to cancel the 4 that was in the numerator. So I start with 1/3 r to the 4th sigma, integral from 0 to pi over 2. And now in this integrand, I have 1 plus the cosine of 2 theta all squared. Now we have to expand that squared binomial, and we get 1 plus 2 cosine 2 theta plus cosine squared 2 theta d theta. Now those first two pieces, we can guess the antiderivatives quickly. The third piece with the cosine squared in it, we have to apply this identity one more time. But when we apply this identity, remember the original angle is now 2 theta. So when we double that, we get a 4 theta. And I'll go ahead and distribute the 1/2 while I'm working. So we can combine the 1 and the 1/2 to give us a 3/2. And now we're ready to guess antiderivatives. So we carry our 1/3 r to the 4th sigma out in front. We get the antiderivative of 3/2, which gives me 3/2 theta. The antiderivative of 2 cosine 2 theta. Well, the chain rule is already taken care of there. This is just sine 2 theta. If you take the derivative of that, you get cosine 2 theta multiplied by the derivative of 2 theta, which is 2. And we apply the chain rule backwards one more time. Cosine 4 theta basically comes from sine 4 theta, but we have to account for a factor of 4 caused by the chain rule. And that goes in the denominator, so that when I differentiate sine 4 theta and the chain rule produces a factor of 4, the factors of 4 cancel, giving me what I started with. This whole thing is evaluated from 0 to pi over 2. And a few really nice things happen here. First, I notice that subbing in the lower limit gives me 0 for every single term because the sine of 0 is 0. So I don't have to worry about that. That's the advantage that we got from cutting the integral in half and doubling the answer. And more really nice things happen because when I sub in the upper limit to these sine terms, the first gives me the sine of 2 theta, which will be the sine of pi, which is 0. The second gives me the sine of 2 pi, which is 0. So both of those are gone. All we have to do is sub in pi over 2 for theta in that first term. And here our factors of 3 are going to cancel. Our leftover constant is a 4 in the denominator. So we have 1/4 r to the 4th sigma times pi. And here's where we have to go back and use the definition of area density. Sigma is the mass of the disk divided by the area of the disk. The mass of the disk was a given in the problem, that's just capital M. And the area can be written as pi r squared. This means our total moment of inertia is going to be 1/4 r to the 4th times sigma, which we now replace with m over pi r squared, multiplied by pi. And we clean things up a little, the pi's cancel. Two factors of r cancel, leaving me with an r squared in the numerator. And we arrive at this beautifully simple result. The moment of inertia of a disk that's being flipped over its diameter is 1/4 mr squared. And we're done. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.